प्रोटोजोआ देर आर वेरी वाइड वेरिटी ऑफ ऑर्गेनिजम्स. प्रोटोजोआ इंक्लूड्स डिफरेंट ऑर्गेनिजम्स, वाइड वेरिटी ऑफ ऑर्गेनिजम्स लाइक अमीबा, पैरामीशियम एटसेट्रा. इफ यू सी द साइज ऑफ दीज ऑर्गेनिजम्स, दे मे बी एज स्मॉल एज 2 माइक्रोमीटर or they can be as large as 200 micrometers. Okay, structurally, you see the structure of these organisms also, very diverse. They are not all having same type of shapes. You take the shape of amoeba, it is irregular in shape. Paramecium is a chappal-shaped organism. Euglena, if you take, it's having a different shape. So there is no uniqueness in the shape of the organism. One larger flagellum and smaller flagellum. So they are of different shapes. On every organism you can see a small outer covering like this. On these protozoans, this is either a pellicle or a cytoskeleton. It can be a pellicle or a cytoskeleton. That means protozoans are covered, their body is covered by a pellicle or a cytoskeleton. In these organisms, you can easily differentiate the cytoplasm into ectoplasm and endoplasm. Ectoplasm is very dilute, whereas endoplasm is very thick and viscous, right? So that is the difference between ectoplasm and endoplasm. That can be clearly visible in these organisms. Okay. If you see the nutrition in these organisms, also is very diverse. For example, if you take amoeba, how does it obtain its nutrition? It takes a whole particle inside. This type of nutrition is called as holozoic nutrition. To take the example of Euglena is an organism which has its own chlorophyll. So this organism can perform photosynthesis. It is autotrophic. It shows autotrophic nutrition. Some organisms cause diseases like Plasmodium. Plasmodium causes malaria in our body. So this is an example for parasitic nutrition. They live in our blood cells and they cause damage to our blood cells. You can also see saprozoic nutrition. Saprozoic nutrition means, in saprozoic nutrition, what is seen is the enzymes are released out of the body and the digested food is taken into the body. This type of nutrition is seen in organisms like Trichonympha. So that is about nutrition. You see the reproduction. Reproduction also is very unique. The reproduction in these organisms is unique. So that means each one is having a different variety. See, you take, for example, amoeba, paramecium. They divide their body into two parts. Their body is divided into two parts by a method called binary fission. Sometimes multiple fission also is seen. Multiple fission is seen in the organisms like Polystomella, not visible. Polystomella. Even in paramecium also, you can see sometimes multiple fission occurs. That means the body of organism divides into several several individuals. Okay, so that type of fission is called as multiple fission. Sometimes you can see conjugation is a type of reproduction. Conjugation is a type of reproduction that is seen in paramecium. Paramecium not only undergoes binary fission and this multiple fission or a type of asexual reproduction, whereas conjugation is a type of sexual reproduction where there is exchange of genetic material. So this is a sexual mode of reproduction. So that is about different types of reproduction that are seen in protozoa. Okay. So each organism is a unique organism. In this protozoa, there it is a combination of different types of organisms. So very diverse set of microorganisms are present in protozoa. You see, if amoeba, it's not having a shape. It is it takes the whole food particle inside. You take, for example, paramecium. It is having small cilia-like structures, and it can move forward to take the food inside. It can perform binary fission, multiple fission, conjugation, different. You see, Euglena is one more different type of organism because it can obtain its food by the autotrophic nutrition. Autotrophic nutrition because chlorophyll is present in that organism, whereas it can also perform nutrition by heterotrophic mode also. In heterotrophic mode, it can take the particles inside. So in this you can see autotrophic nutrition also, heterotrophic nutrition also. Okay, so that is the reason why this is not considered as an algae, or else it would be considered as a unicellular algae. It can perform autotrophic nutrition also, it can perform heterotrophic nutrition also. So we can see that there are wide variety of organisms seen in this protozoa. Now let us move to the second type of microorganism, I mean next type of microorganisms, that is algae. Algae, as we know, they are having their own chlorophyll. They can perform their own new photosynthesis process. So we'll discuss about algae just a minute. Right. Algae. Algae are the group of organisms which are having chlorophyll and they can perform photosynthesis. These organisms, either they are unicellular like Chlamydomonas is unicellular, or they are colonial means they live, large group of organisms live as colonies. For example, wallwax makes a globe like this around itself, and these cells are present inside this globe like colony. So example for colonial, wallwax. There are certain filamentous organisms, for example, Spirogyra. This is a chloroplast. Filamentous chloroplast is present in these organisms. So this is Spirogyra. This is one. Spirogyra. But they are attached to each other because of a mucilage that is present. So around this there is a mucilage sheath. It connects these individual cells. So many Spirogyra are connected to each other like this. This mucilage keep them in contact to each other. So this is an example for filamentous spiral gyra. In these organisms, we can see not only chlorophyll, apart from chlorophyll, there are xanthophyll, another pigment which is xanthophyll, another pigment which is yellow, brownish yellow in color. You can also see phycoerythrin, which makes them appear red in color, phycocyanin, some of the pigments. These are some of the pigments that are present in plants, okay, present in algae. Okay, if they are red in color, that is because of phycoerythrin, phycocyanin, because blue color is because of phycocyanin, and yellow color is because of xanthophyll. These pigments are also present in algae. Sometimes we can see yellow algae, brown algae, red algae. That is because of these different pigments that are present inside the algae. Okay, how do they reproduce? Reproduction in these organisms is either by fragmentation. Fragmentation occurs when a small fragment of, take for example, spirogyra is there. A small fragment of this spirogyra will separate and it grows into a complete individual. It grows into a complete individual. Okay? This type of reproduction is called as fragmentation, sometimes by spores formation. Spores formation is seen in algae, in which these spores are not sexual spores, they are asexual spores. Zoospores are formed, aplanospores are formed, different types of spores are formed. Okay, or by gamete formation also we can see the reproduction. Like in higher plants, male gamete is formed, female gamete is formed, pollen grain, all these by gamete formation also they can be seen. So the same, the mode that is seen in higher plants, same like that in gamete formation is seen in small algae also. Okay, what is the difference between higher plants and algae structurally? In plants you can see root formation, stem formation, but in algae there is only thallus formation. Thallus means no stems, no roots, no leaves. But what is there? Just a bunch of cells, a group of cells. Group of cells, okay? Some of them will modify themselves to form the gametes. They fuse together and perform the sexual reproduction. Okay. So, some of the algae like diatoms are the sea creatures. They have a silica shell around them. This silica that is present around their body will get deposited whenever the diatoms are, they are brown, yellowish brown in color, yellowish brown in color. They are found in ocean and marine waters, and these will have a silica shell around them. That silica cell will get deposited in the bed of the ocean. Whenever diatoms will die, all that silica will come down. Whenever the death of diatoms occurs, they'll form a continuous layer of bed over the ocean, and this is called as diatomaceous earth. Diatomaceous earth. This is very important one, because it is very brittle. Okay, if it is ground very brittle, it is found. Okay, so this can be useful in even they can be used in filtration of oils. Filtration of oils. They are also used in polishing, etc. So it is a very precious thing like that. Not only this, there is an algae called Saccharosum. Saccharosum. Sorry, Sargassum. So this is a very widespread algae. Suppose if you take in Atlantic Ocean itself, it spreads to 6,400 kilometers square. So very wide area is being occupied by this algae. So this part of Atlantic Ocean is called as Sargassum Sea. Right? So we'll see what are the economic importance of this also. Economic importance of this algae also we'll see. This, I said, your diatomaceous earth that is obtained from the remnants of diatoms is used in filtration of oils, in polishing, etc. Apart from that, there are so many uses. Like, for example, you take this Sargassum, it is used as an feed for domestic animals. It is used as feed for domestic animals. Apart from that, fucus, laminaria, are some other algae that are processed to use as they undergo a little bit of processing. Later they are used as animal feeds. Animal feed. You take, for example, Glycyrrhiza, Geladium. These are the algae from which agar gel is obtained. Agar gel is very important. It is usually liquid in nature, but it can be solidified, and it has very wide range of use in biotechnology fields. In field of biotechnology, in field of research, this is a very important gel that is obtained from Glycyrrhiza and Geladium. And ash of the kelp also is useful. If the kelp is burnt, I'll say one minute. When the kelp of laminaria and fucus is burnt, why I am saying this as kelp is, when the algae grows in a wide area, it starts more than several meters, if it is occupying several meters, then it is called as kelp. Kelp is nothing but algae that grows to several meters. This kelp, if it is burnt, the ash that is obtained from this is used in making soap, glass, etc. Okay? So these are some of the uses of algae. Apart from that, you can see that chlorella is a good source of vitamin B6. Spirogyra, vitamin B and also protein. Spirogyra is a very good source of protein. So they can be used as supplements. They are very good rich, components of vitamin B and protein. Spirogyra is rich in protein. They can be used as supplements for the food. Okay, algae tastes very bad, but those who want very good nutrients, they take this as small bits of tablets, and that is very good for good supplement for the deficient people. Apart from this, there are some other uses. So the I said you some of the important uses of algae. You can see them like in sewage industry also, it's very useful. Sewage industry, what is usually done? The waste that is present is aerobic bacteria is added. Aerobic bacteria is added for this, so that this is decomposed. Usually this waste is present in water. Sewage means wastewater, really, no. On this waste, aerobic bacteria is added so that this waste will be decomposed. But this aerobic bacteria needs oxygen. For that, usually chlorella is added in this water, so that if chlorella grows, this chlorella releases out oxygen. It uses all the carbon dioxide that is produced as a decomposition, as a result of decomposition. So this water becomes oxygen rich. When oxygen is more, aerobic bacteria is active, decomposition occurs. Carbon dioxide is released, that is used by chlorella. So in this way it is very useful. Okay, when the waste is decomposed by aerobic bacteria, carbon dioxide released. Carbon dioxide is used by chlorella, and it releases oxygen. That oxygen is used by aerobic bacteria, and it decomposes sewage waste. So in this way it is used. You can see the use of chlorella by space people who go in space. There, in their spacecraft, this chlorella is grown for the same reason. It produces oxygen and uses up carbon dioxide. Okay, so the space of the air that is present in that spacecraft will be it becomes rich of oxygen, and all the carbon dioxide present is used up. In that way also it is used. And you can see that Spirogyra is used as food by this people who go out in space. Since this is a protein rich food, and it can be easily carried, so this Spirogyra is used as a food by this astronauts, right? It also helps in algae helps in cleaning the environment also. So much algae is present in ocean waters, in pond waters, that helps in adding more oxygen to the environment, and it uses more carbon dioxide from the environment. So these are some of the uses of algae.